Hey, it's great to see you, church. Let's stand together and let's worship our great God this morning.
Strong in battle. Hey, welcome to Central Baptist Church. We are so glad that you're here today. I cannot contain my excitement because this Wednesday at 7 o'clock, we're going to be able to meet together up here at the church in this building and worship together. I'm super excited about it because I haven't seen your beautiful faces in so long in person. I've seen them on Skype or Zoom, and I've seen them on Facebook, I've seen them on Instagram, but I haven't been able to actually sit down and have a conversation with you guys. And we get to worship this Wednesday, and it's going to be awesome. Kind of a laid-back service, so just come as you are. And as we continue to go through the phases of meeting together again. So there's Wednesday night, and then on Sunday, we're going to meet again together for a worship service on Sunday morning. I know you guys are excited. This has been a long process, but we're going to meet together again. We're going to meet at 8 o'clock for the first service and 11 for the second service. And if you are able to come, we would love for you to join us. Invite the people that you've been wanting to invite during this quarantine time to show up to church, and we're just going to have a great worship experience. So, and then if you're not able to actually come up to the church, if you're still uncomfortable with coming or you're not able to, that's fine, because we're going to continue to stream our services at 11 o'clock. And so you can go to YouTube or Facebook or just our website, and you can watch our services there as well, just like you're watching right now. So we're excited. And as we continue to you know, with all this excitement, pray for us. Pray for our church. Pray that we can, when we meet together, that it can just be a wonderful experience for us. Right now I'm going to pray and we're going to continue in worship. But just keep that heart of worship inside of your mind. As we go through today, as we go through the next few weeks of transitioning and kind of filling out things, we want to know we're making a space that we can all meet together, we can all worship God. Let's pray. Dear God, you are gracious and you are so good. Thank you so much for allowing us to meet together in this way so we can hear about you. I pray for the services that are going to come in the next few weeks. I pray for Wednesday at 7, that you will just move through your people to worship you, to give you the glory, God. And then next Sunday, as we meet together for the first time in a while on a Sunday morning, I pray that you will bless that time. And as we continue during this time, God, just bless the service, bless all those who are involved in it, and bless those viewers that are viewing at home. We love you, Jesus. We always give you glory and praise forever and always. Amen.
shake before you, the demons run and flee. At the mention of your name, King of Majesty, there is no power in hell or any who can stand before the power and the presence of the great I am.
Hope you're enjoying your online worship experience, and this will be part of the worship service that we will be taking up the offering. And personally, I just want to say thank you for those of you who have been giving. It's so important, and as you can see on the bottom of the screen, there's a lot of different ways to give. You can keep mailing it in, for many of you have been doing that, or you can go to our website and look for the giving portion there, or on the app on your phone, or you can even text it in and all that information is scrolling across your phone. And right now it's so important because we're gearing up to start back at worship here on Sunday, June the 14th. And we're having to make a lot of different changes here to be ready for that. And that unfortunately does cost us some money. So we appreciate that. And if you're prepared to give today, we would really appreciate your sacrificial giving for that. But on that Sunday, June the 14th, when you return, one of the changes you're gonna see is there won't be a time where we're actually passing the offering plate. But there'll be a table out in the foyer where you can grab your own envelope, fill it out as you want. But as you leave, each of the exits coming out of the worship service and even exiting the building, you're gonna see a little box like this. And all you have to do is drop your offering envelope straight into there, and that's all you'll need to do. And so, again, I wanted to just say thank you, and let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we know everything belongs to you, and help us be good stewards of all your resources. And what we're asking is, as the money comes in, give us wisdom and discernment to honor you on how we're using it for your kingdom. And we give you all the glory, and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Gosh, I love playing with cars. I love construction stuff.
Yeah.
Hey guys, you know what's coming up soon?
What?
VBS.
I love VBS.
Yes. Are you gonna go to VBS this year?
Well, my mama said I can't go unless there's an hand sanitizer.
Well, my mom says that there's more hand sanitizer than you can dream of.
My mama said that there's supposed to be one at every door.
My mommy said there is going to be one at every door.
Okay, then I better tell my mommy. So
I love hand sanitizer. Jeremy juice! And I get it, and I slam it, and I got this, and it gets in my eyes!
Hey, why do you guys have mustaches and I don't have a mustache?
Because we're construction workers.
Because I'm a man.
There, I have a mustache!
Yeah!
I must ask you a question.
What?
What's your favorite part of VBS?
My favorite part is... the snacks!
Ooh, I like the snacks. The snacks are the best.
And my favorite part is while we do all the dance motion.
You're a good dancer.
I'm a crane.
You're like the best dancer ever.
Well, I know. I'm a great crane.
You know what my favorite part is?
What?
Crafts. Whenever I grow up, I think I'm going to be a crafts lady.
Wow.
And do crafts. Because like you get to have glue and scissors. I don't get to have scissors right now.
No.
I love to put glue on my hands and peel it off.
I do too. Do you eat it?
Sometimes. If the snacks aren't very good.
You're not supposed to eat it.
Mm-mm.
Well, I tell you what. I have a new video for us to watch about VBS, so we'll know what it's about.
I love VBS.
It's Concrete and Cranes. It's the best song ever. So you ready?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Everybody ready?
Oh,
I'm
yeah.
ready.
Watch this.
I love to build things. It's fun that you just have the freedom to build whatever you want.
Put on your hard hat. Cinch up your tool belt for a groundbreaking VBS.
I'm excited about Concrete and Cranes.
As kids explore a world of concrete and cranes, rivets and rebar, bulldozers and backhoes, they will discover that skyscrapers aren't the only thing that need a rock-solid foundation.
I would love to drive an excavator and dig in the ground.
During VBS, Bible stories of love, forgiveness, and resurrection pave the way to a faith built on Jesus, a faith built to last.
Wrecking balls are the best because they're big and they can smash a lot of things.
At Concrete and Cranes VBS, kids uncover truth as they rotate through missions, music, snacks, and recreation. All week, you'll hammer in on Philippians 1:6, which reveals God's plan for knowing you through Jesus.
Today in Bible study, we learned about Matthew following Jesus when he just said, "Follow me," and he made the decision right away that he'd follow him.
Each activity is designed to help kids experience Jesus, our strong foundation.
I learned that Jesus loves me.
Jesus our strong foundation.
Life is a hard hat zone. Give kids a VBS that measures up with Lifeway's Concrete and Cranes.
Well, good morning, everyone. I'm so glad you guys are with us for our final and last Sunday of being online together for a worship service. And I'm so excited about next week where we get to be together on campus. So June 14th, I know we've said it several times already, but June 14th, we are beginning our worship services here on campus. We'll have an 8 o'clock service and an 11 o'clock service. And we want you guys to come and be a part of that. We still are doing our Sunday school classes in the morning in between those two services at 9:30. And so there's about a 30 minute gap in between all those different activities, which will give you time to come to our campus and join us for worship. And so we want to invite you to come and do that. And if you can, that's great. And if you can't, it's okay, because we're still going to have an incredible online presence. And you can still watch on YouTube or on Facebook or on our website, or however you're watching us right now. You can still do that if you're not comfortable coming and being on campus with us. And I tell you, we're so excited about this that actually we can't even wait till the 14th. And so on the 10th, June the 10th, this Wednesday, we are having a special night of worship and prayer. And so we want to invite you to come and be a part of that at 7 o'clock as well. It's going to just be really laid back. Just come and join us, and we're going to kick this off right, you know? We're going to get together and we're going to pray to the Lord. We're going to thank Him for all He's done in the middle of this chaos. He has done some incredible things, hasn't He? And we're gonna worship Him as well. And so we want you to come and be a part of that as well. So, you know, this week is a little different. The message today is going to be a little bit different. Couple of disclaimers. One, we're filming this on Wednesday, and I am sitting here in my office, and we don't know what, by the time this airs on Sunday, what our political and cultural climate is going to look like. But we are speaking about this this week, about everything that's kind of going on in our culture and in our country. And it makes me sad. It makes me anxious. You know, the Bible gives me hope. And so we're gonna turn to the Lord today and see what He has to say to us. But I'd like just to spend just a second and pray over this message today, because it's a little bit difficult one. And we'll continue. So would you pray with me? Father, thank you for your word. And I just simply pray, God, that you would speak to us this morning. God, that the message that you've given me will make sense, and that'll be what we need to hear. And we thank you, God, that we have the scriptures, that we don't have to rely on our own thoughts. We don't have to rely on our own politics or our own opinions. But God, we can go to your word, and we can find truth even for the things of today. So help us, God, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I love to go skiing up in Colorado. And man, I've been doing that since I was really little. And I love being up on the mountains, and when it's cold and you're just, you know, bundled up, and always have goggles on so you can see everything better. But sometimes the climate where you're at is so cold, and maybe you're so just steaming hot because you're working up a sweat skiing, that your goggles will begin to fog over. And it happens to me all the time. And so I'll take my goggles off, and sometimes I'll just spit in them and just try to clean them out on the inside. Or you got the solution you can put on the inside, and sometimes it'll help for a while, but it never fails. For some reason with me, my goggles continue just to fog up over and over again. And then that's difficult. When you're skiing down a mountain, trying not to kill yourself, and you really can't see where you're going, that's not a good recipe for success. In fact, I remember one story of a picture that I have of a friend of mine. He took of me when we were skiing, and we were skiing, just having a great time. And I kind of got way ahead of him, and he was filming everything, and just filming me in front of him. And we were just skiing and laughing. And then all of a sudden, all he saw was just this giant like puff of snow. And he comes and skis by me and takes this picture. And it's of me and my legs are completely upside down. All you can see is kind of the top of my boots and or my legs and my skis just sticking way out because I couldn't see where I was going. The fog in my goggles had just completely kind of covered me up. And I couldn't see what was in front of me. And I hit a patch of snow and just flipped and busted. And it was just, it was hilarious. But I was just thinking about that, about not being able to see things. And then all of a sudden, you clean your goggles and you are able to see. And I think this week or the last week and a half has been really eye-opening for a lot of us. It's helped us to see things maybe in a little bit different way. And so there's some things that I've been able to realize based off of the protests and everything that's happened is this, that people are hurting. People that I didn't even realize were hurting because of racial tension, those people are really hurting. And the death of George Floyd, that was terrible. And it should never have happened. And we condemn that. We don't ever want to see someone abused and hurt in that way. And it's terrible that has happened in our country. But it has really sparked something that has kind of gotten out of control. And I realize that people are hurting. But there's also something that I've realized, and maybe you have realized as well, is that maybe my heart needs to change. And maybe I need to look at, like, introspectively at my life. And is there things going on in my heart when it comes to people that are different than me that I need to change? And so I've just this week been really contemplating on what God would have us to talk about and to share this morning. And over again, my heart has just been turned to Scripture over and over again. And I don't want to get into the politics of all this. And honestly, I don't even want to really just try to just give you all of my opinions. I want to go to God's Word because the current racial climate is something that we need to gain wisdom on how to deal with. And the reality is, you may say, you know, Clayton, this has nothing really to do with me. And directly, you may be right that this current racial situation has really nothing to do with you. You're not directly involved in it at all, besides just watching it on the news. But the reality is, you may not be the problem, but you are called to be a part of the solution. And we were all called to do that. I think about the nation of Israel and over again, they would fall away from the Lord. They would stop doing what God had called them to do. And God's wrath would come upon them. And they would be taken over by other countries. They would feel the consequences of God and falling away from the Lord. And I was thinking about this, that does that mean that every single person in the entire people group, all of the Jews, that every single one, millions of them had turned, all of them turned away from God? I don't think that happened in the Old Testament, but I think there were lots of people that did that. And God, he grouped them together and said, you know what, you're all in this together. And they're all in this together because even though some were doing the wrong thing, there were a lot of people that didn't do anything about it. And God said, okay, you're going to feel the consequences of your sin. I think that is a great example for us today that we are called to do something about this. Even if we're not directly involved in this racial tension and these protests, we are called to do something about it. We need to have a biblical response. And so as your pastor, that's what we're going to do today. We're just going to jump into God's Word and talk a little bit about this subject, this subject that is really important for us today. And so I was thinking about what is the right terminology that we need to have in the middle of this. And we can use the word racism. This is something that you've probably heard on the news and seen on TV a whole lot on social media about what racism is. And I was thinking, what really is racism? Well, racism, it's based on fear. And it's believing a race is superior or inferior than another race. And so I hate the word racism because I think it kind of shows or kind of just subconsciously tells us there are different races. And the reality is there's not different races. There is one race. It is the human race. And it's the race that God created to be like him, his image bearer. And we see that from the very beginning. We have Adam and Eve. We are all the kids of Adam and Eve. And then when Noah got to start everything over, we are all of descendants of Noah. And as people spread across the world, different people groups were created. And they began to look a little bit different than each other. And they began to talk different than each other. But the reality is that we are all the same. We are one race. And so I don't like to use the word racism. I'd rather use the word prejudice. I think it's a better terminology for what's really going on today. And prejudice, we kind of just look at the word, it's prejudge, like prejudice, that's what that really means. And what prejudice is when we make a judgment about someone without having all the facts. Think about that, man. I think we do that a lot. Maybe it's something we don't realize, but we judge people without knowing everything about them, not knowing their current situation, what's going on in their life. We judge entire people groups with maybe just subconsciously without really understanding what we're doing. And so I think that's a better term that kind of talks about the issues for today is prejudice. Because really prejudice is the foundation of racism. And we are people in the United States, people around the world, have racist tendencies because they prejudge people. They're prejudiced. And so I think it's good for us to look at the Bible and see what it has to say about prejudice. And so there's one story that I think is amazing. It's in Luke chapter 4. So your Bibles turn to Luke 4. We're going to be in verse 14 and kind of go through this story. And Jesus is returning to Galilee, and he gets to go back to his hometown. I don't know about you guys, going back to your hometown is just different. You go back, and last week we got to go to Holly's hometown where she grew up in Bartlesville, and it was just surreal for her to be able to see all the different places and remember all those things, how she grew up, and it was very memorable to her. And Jesus goes back to Nazareth, to his hometown, and read this story, and it's an incredible story of the Jewish people and the things that were going on as a culture in their lives. So let's look at it. Here's what it says. Then Jesus returned to Galilee. He was filled with the Holy Spirit's power. Reports about him spread quickly through the whole region. And he taught regularly in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. And when he came to the village of Nazareth, his boyhood home, he went as usual to the synagogue on the Sabbath and stood up to read the scriptures. So he goes to church on Sunday morning, and he has the honor and privilege because people knew who he was, and he was getting popular at that time. And he gets to stand up and he gets to read the scriptures. So he opens the scroll and he opens to Isaiah, it says in verse 17. The scroll of Isaiah the prophet was handed to him, and he unrolled the scroll and found the place where this was written. So he goes to Isaiah chapter 61 and he begins to read. And he says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim that captives will be released, that the blind will see, that the oppressed will be set free, and that the time of the Lord's favor has come." And he rolls up the scroll, hands it back, and he goes and sits down. And the Bible says that all eyes in the synagogue looked at him intently. And then he began to speak to them, and he says this, "The scripture you've just heard has been fulfilled this very day." And so what he's saying is that, hey guys, I have fulfilled that. The Messiah has come, and I am that Messiah. Now that was a profound statement. And it's interesting to see what the people do around here in verse 22. They say this, it says this, "Everyone spoke well of him and was amazed by the gracious words that came from his lips." They said, "How can this be?" They asked, "Isn't this Joseph's son?" And they were like, "This is incredible." And they were, in essence, they were praising him, saying, "Wow, that's amazing that you're doing that. It's crazy." And if you know the rest of the story, that's pretty profound that they would say that. They would be like, "Oh yeah, this is, man, we're right tracking with you, Jesus, man. You're calling yourself the Messiah. All right, we're on board." And Jesus doesn't stop there. He goes on and says this, and this is what I want to kind of focus on today. Verse 23 says, "Then he said, 'You will undoubtedly quote me this proverb, and the proverb is, physician, heal yourself, meaning do miracles here in your hometown like those you did in Capernaum. But I tell you the truth, no prophet is accepted in his own hometown.'" And then he goes to the Old Testament. He tells them two stories real quickly that that they knew. He first goes to 1 Kings 17, and he says, "Certainly there were many needy widows in Israel in Elijah's time, when the heavens were closed for 3.5 years, and a severe famine devastated the land. Yet Elijah, he was not sent to any of them. He was sent instead to a foreigner, a widow of Zarephath in the land of Sidon." So he tells this story and the people are like, "What? Don't remind us of that." And then he doesn't stop there, and he goes to 2 Kings chapter 5, the next verse, and he tells a story about another prophet. So he tells a story about Elijah, but then he tells a story about Elisha. And he says this in verse 27, "And many in Israel had leprosy in the time of the prophet Elisha, but the only one healed was Naaman, a Syrian." And when they heard this, the people in the synagogue were furious. They completely changed their tone and their tune towards Jesus. When Jesus said, hey, let me remind you about something about the Old Testament when God showed up through the prophets, but not for the Israelites. He showed up for foreigners. And the Bible says in verse 29 that they jumped up and they mobbed him and they forced him to the edge of the hill on which the town was built. And they intended to push him over the cliff to kill Jesus because of what he said. But he passed right through the crowd and went on his way. And they were so mad because in this story, in this Old Testament story, the Gentiles, they were given grace and they were cared for by God. And the Jewish prophets, they went to the Gentiles and they received God's word. And for the Jews, they were so mad because they had prejudice in their hearts. They were prejudiced. The Jewish people were really prejudiced back then because they thought that they were the chosen race. They had been told by God that they are God's chosen people. And they had taken that, not realizing that the reason they were God's chosen people is so that they could tell other people, the Gentiles, the rest of the world, about God and the Messiah. Instead, they said, you know what? All this is for us. The law is just for us. The Messiah is just for us. And Jesus says, no, that's not what the kingdom of God is about. The kingdom of God is for ethnically different people all over the world. God is for all of those people. The Messiah is for all of those people. And they were so mad because they thought that they were superior and better than everybody else. And here's what I think happened in their lives. They failed to see others through God's eyes. They failed to love others through God's heart as well. And I think that we need to understand first that racism is real. Racism is something that really does impact our society, is something that we deal with. Racism or prejudice is real. And they failed to see other people through God's eyes. They failed to see other people and treat other people the way that God would treat them through God's heart. So how in the world are we supposed to know what God's eyes and God's heart are for other people? Well, we see that in Jesus. And so even though racism is real, prejudice is real, you know what? So is Jesus. Jesus is real as well. And I'll tell you this just simply today, that Jesus, he is the answer to racism. And he is the answer to prejudice all over the world and even in our society today. And so what did Jesus do? If Jesus is the answer, if he is real as well, what did he do? How did he respond? Well, Jesus' main audience were the Jewish people. He came and he preached and he taught to the Jewish people. But over and over and over again, he went to people that were different than the Jews. And we see this when he healed people that the Jews would consider an outcast. And he would go to Samaria and he would spend time with people there who the Jews would consider second-class citizens. And here's what Jesus is saying. He is saying that I am the end of racism and I am the end of prejudice. I'm the end of all those things. All those things end with me. He was willing to go and treat people who were different than Jews and treat them well. I think about my grandmother. I called her Mimi. And she was 4 foot, I don't know, like 4 foot seven or eight, nine, I don't know. She was really, really short. And she was just an incredible lady, woman of God. And man, I miss her today. But she lived behind me when we were growing up. And so I had kind of like two homes when I would get out of school, in elementary school or middle school, and got to spend tons of time with my Mimi. And I would always go over there and she would always feed me after school. She would feed me Campbell's SpaghettiOs. And man, I can still taste them right now as I tell this story. Campbell's SpaghettiOs, which man, now I eat those. I'm like, oh my goodness, Campbell ate those all the time. But I loved Campbell's SpaghettiOs. My Mimi, she would give those to me all the time. And anytime I brought friends over, she would feed them as well. Anytime we had relatives over, other people, and we'd go over to my Mimi's house, I would we'd jump right in to the kitchen, and my Mimi would get up and she would cook us something. Because here's the deal. Just because she loved me as her grandson doesn't mean that she treated other people different. When I would bring other people over to her house, she loved them just like they were one of her grandkids. And I think that's a great kind of example of how Jesus was, is that he treated people the same regardless of who they were. Paul echoes this in Colossians chapter 3, verse 11. He says this, in this new life, it doesn't matter if you are a Jew or a Gentile. It doesn't matter anymore, guys. Whether you're circumcised or uncircumcised, barbaric, uncivilized, whether you're a slave or whether you're free, here's what he says. Christ is all that matters, and he lives in all of us. Man, that is a powerful statement, that Christ is all that matters anymore. That is, he is who defines us. It's no longer what your ethnic group is. It's whether you have the blood of Christ covering over your sins. Christ is all that matters, and he lives in all of us. Jesus, he changes everything. We also see in Galatians chapter 3, verses 26 through 29, that the gospel has something to say about racism and prejudice. It says this, "For you're all children of God." How? We are children of God through faith in who? In Christ Jesus. "And all who have been united with Christ in baptism have put on Christ, like putting on new clothes." And he says this in verse 28, kind of the linchpin for all this. "There is no longer Jew or Gentile, slave or free, male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus." You're no longer different. Those things don't define you anymore. What defines you is Jesus. "And now that you belong to Christ, you are the true children of Abraham. You are his heirs, and God's promise to Abraham belongs to you." And that is a profound statement, especially for a Jewish person to read that, because that was for them. To be the heir of Abraham, to have the promise, the covenant between God and Abraham, to have that in their lineage, and that was everything to them. They were the children of Abraham, and Jesus is saying, or Paul is saying, that through Jesus, we are all children of Abraham. And that is just an incredible statement right there. And I think it's something we need to realize, that the true gospel message, the gospel message is this, is that we need to treat people not based on ethnicity, the differences that maybe we think would define us, but we need to treat people based on Jesus' blood. And Jesus' blood is for everyone. I love Billy Graham. I love listening to his sermons and the things that he had to say. And he said this once about the things that we're dealing with. He said, "Jesus, he was not a white man. He was not a black man. He came from that part of the world that touches Africa and Asia and Europe. Christianity is not a white man's religion, and don't let anybody ever tell you that it's white or black. Christ belongs to all people. He belongs to the whole world." The gospel, it has the unique ability to bring people together. People that are different, it helps us who are ethnically different, it helps us to come together in unity. So what must be our response? As we looked at just those two little topics today, looking at that scripture, what must be our response? If we realize that racism is real, but Jesus is real as well, and he has a response to that, and the blood of Christ changes everything, what Jesus has done on the cross for every one of us, it changes everything. What needs to be our response? Well, there's one other story I want to share with you real quick. It's in Galatians chapter 2. And it's when Paul, he traveled to Antioch. And Antioch was the third largest city in the Roman Empire. So it's a big place. They think that there was probably about 500,000 people in Antioch. And there were over about 65,000 Jewish people in the city as well. And many of them became Christians. And so they had this their own little group that they were like Jewish Christians. And so they were believers in Christ, but they had been previously Jews, and so they held on to a lot of the Jewish practices and thought they were different than even the Gentile people, the pagans who became Christians. They kind of separated themselves from them. And there was a lot of prejudice and racism going on in Antioch. And read a story that about 10 years before Paul wrote Galatians, before he tells this story, the emperor of Rome, his name is Caligula, he actually attacked the Jews. Many of them were killed, and their synagogues were burned. I mean, it was kind of like riots going on like today, except for it was brutal with the Romans. They completely devastated the Jewish people. And so 10 years later, Paul writes this and tells about this story. He says this, "But when Peter came to Antioch, I had to oppose him to his face, for what he did was very wrong." So Paul, he's telling this story about Peter. You know, Peter, the rock of the church. And he's saying, man, I had to confront Peter. When I went to Antioch, I had to confront him because of what he did. And verse 12 says, it tells a story. He says, "When he first arrived," talking about Peter, "he ate with the Gentile believers who were not circumcised. But afterward, when some friends of James came," other versions say that they were Jewish Christians, Peter wouldn't eat with the Gentiles anymore. And he was afraid of criticism from these people who insisted on the necessity of circumcision. And so, what's the story? What's going on? So Peter, he's going and he's hanging out with the Gentile believers. Man, they're having fellowship together. They're doing kind of like the Acts early church stuff. They're spending time together and they're doing life together. But all of a sudden, a bunch of Jewish Christians come. And Peter, being a Jewish Christian himself, when he realized that they were coming, he kind of slowly backed away. The Greek here actually means he didn't like immediately do that. He just kind of slowly backed away, trying not to offend. I don't want to offend these people. But he was being very hypocritical in his life. And he began to slowly back away and quit living life with the Gentile believers. Because of the Jewish believers who had come, who were preaching a different gospel than Paul was preaching. And so Paul had to over and over again say, hey, here is what the gospel is about. It's not about being Jewish anymore and having and obeying the law. It's about Jesus and how he brings us together. And he says this in verse 14. When I saw that they were not following the truth of the gospel message, I said to Peter in front of all the others, since you, a Jew by birth, have discarded the Jewish laws and are living like a Gentile, why are you now trying to make these Gentiles follow the Jewish traditions? You and I are Jews by birth, not sinners like the Gentiles. Yet we know that a person is made right with God by faith in Jesus Christ, not by obeying the law. And we have believed in Christ Jesus so that we might be made right with God because of our faith in Christ, not because we have obeyed the law. For no one will ever be made right with God by obeying the law. Here's what Paul asked Peter. Why are you treating other people differently? Why are you treating other people differently? And he says this to him. This is not how Christians are supposed to act. So I think there's two things here that happen in this story. We don't read about them, but we kind of can imply that this happened. First thing is this, that Paul forgave Peter. We see that they had a reconciled relationship, that Paul eventually forgave Peter. And we also see that Peter repented of what he was doing and how he was acting. And so how can we apply this to our lives today? Just simply this. We can do this. We can forgive and we can repent. When we're talking about being prejudiced towards other people, people that maybe look differently than us, we can forgive and repent. So if you have been a victim of racism or prejudice or discrimination, here's what I believe God is calling you to do. He's calling you to forgive. And that may be really difficult, but here's what the Bible says. Ephesians 4, 31 and 32 says this, get rid of all bitterness. Get rid of all rage. Get rid of all anger, harsh words, and slander, as well as all types of evil behavior. And instead, be kind to each other, tenderhearted, and get this, forgiving one another, just as God through Christ has forgiven you. They may not deserve it. The people that have maybe treated you differently, they've had prejudice towards you or racist towards you, they may not deserve it. But you know what? You didn't deserve God's forgiveness either. And I didn't deserve God's forgiveness, but he gives it to us freely, and God wants us to be like him. And he calls us to forgive one another just as God forgave us. So we need to forgive. But you know what? If you've been someone who practices racism, you practice prejudice or discrimination, here's what you need to do. You need to be like Peter. You need to repent. We need to repent of what's going on in our lives. I love the story of Job and the things that he went through. And man, he went through just a whirlwind of trouble. And yet he kept his faith in the Lord. And at the end of the story, in Job 42, he's talking to God, finally gives a response back to God. In verse 5 and 6, he says this, my ears have heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you. He's saying, I realize my wrong. Like, I know the truth. I mean, the truth is in me, but I've just never like put it together. I've never applied it to my life. And I finally have done that. And he says this, therefore, I despise myself and I repent in dust and in ashes. Job says, man, God, I'm sorry. I realize where I'm wrong and I'm repenting. You know what? I think there's something that we need to do. We all need to take a look at our hearts and we all must repent And repentance means to walk differently, to realize you're wrong and turn and go and live in a different way. So here's one way. I think there's so many different things we can think about and talk about today. But I was thinking about what is something, some one way that we can begin to make a difference in our society. And I think it's this. We can transfer our values to those around us. So I think not only can we forgive and repent, but you can transfer your values to those people around you. And so maybe that's your family. Maybe that is your children, your great-grandchildren, your grandchildren, your coworkers, people on social media, online, that you have influence and you're friends with. You can transfer your values, your biblical values, into their lives. And this is going to take a while. Honestly, these are generational issues that we're dealing with. Prejudice is something that's kind of ingrained in us based on a lot of times how we live and who we live next to and how we were raised. But it's something that can be changed over and over over time, and it can really make a big impact in people's lives. And let me show you why. In Exodus chapter 20, verses 5 and 6, we're talking about the Ten Commandments, and God is saying, don't have idols. And he says this, "You must not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God who will not tolerate your affection for any other gods. I lay the sins," get this, "I lay the sins of the parents upon their children. The entire family is affected, even children in the third and fourth generations of those who reject me. But I lavish unfailing love for 1,000 generations on those who love me and obey my commands." Here's what God is saying. He's saying our sins can be handed down. He's saying that we have influence with people in our lives. And so parents, you need to check how you are raising your kids. Grandparents, you need to check how you are loving on your grandkids. Bosses, you need to check how you're interacting with your coworkers and treating them. We need to make sure that we are thinking about how we are influencing people all around us. Our sins can be handed down. Our racism can be handed down. Our prejudice can be handed down. And you know what we need to do? We need to repent and turn from those things. But you know something else can be handed down? And I'll finish with this. Our love for people can be handed down. And that's what I mean by influencing people around you, influencing the next generation to be different, to not have the same prejudices that maybe your generation had. John 13, 34 and 35 says this. And I'll close with this. "So now I am giving you a new commandment. Love each other. Just as I have loved you, you should love each other. Your love for one another will prove this to the world that you are my disciples." And I think it's crazy how just in a few short weeks we've transitioned from a viral pandemic to a cultural pandemic. And I think God is saying not only do we have a cultural pandemic going on, but we have a spiritual pandemic going on. Romans 10:12 says that there is no difference between us. Because of Jesus, there is no difference in people that maybe look differently or act differently or come from a different place than us. And if this is true, and if you believe the gospel, here's what God is calling us to do. He's calling us to forgive. He's calling us to repent. And he's calling us to change our ways for the next generation. So I pray that as a church, we can be a great example for people in our community, for people in our neighborhoods, that we can start something new and let others see the love of Jesus in our lives. Church, it's time for us to be the church so that everybody can see Jesus. Would you pray with me? Father, thank you for the goodness that we have through the gospel, through the shed blood of Jesus on the cross to forgive not just the sins of a certain group of people, but the sins of everyone all over the world. And God, because of your love for everyone, we should have that same love. And your love shows in the way you treated Jesus, the way you treated people who were different than the Jews, the way you treated them shows all of us, God, that there is no difference between us. It doesn't matter where we came from, our ancestors came from, or what we look like. God, we are all the same in your eyes. And God, I want to have your eyes, and I want to have your heart towards other people. And I pray that everyone who's listening today, the people of Central Baptist Church, that we would have those same things. We have those same characteristics, that we would want to be holy as God is holy, as Jesus is holy. We would want to have your eyes and have your heart. So God, help us to check our hearts. And if there's any prejudice in us, God, that we would repent. God, if we have dealt with racism and prejudice in our lives, God, I pray that you would help us to forgive others. And Lord, I pray that you would help us to transfer our values to the next generation and people all around us. And may we change this country. God, may you change this country and this culture through us. And we pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Well, thanks so much for joining us for our final online-only service here at Central. I'm standing out in front of what has been for the last 3 months my worship center on Sunday mornings. Our Sunday school room has been in there, and my workplace and office has been in there a lot of these days, much like you guys, I'm sure, have experienced during this time. And I'm super excited to get back into worship with you all. But my hope and our staff's hope has been that God truly would use this time to really grow our families closer together as we have been able to worship together in these weird and awkward times, but in a cool way with our families. I know for me and our family, it's been great to have some quality time where we can really open up the Word and talk with our kids and just have church in a new and a weird and fresh, cool way. So I hope that God has used that in your life. And today, if you have any questions for us about maybe something that Clayton said, or you just need some prayer, feel free to reach out to the staff, and we can't wait to come back and worship with you this next week. So until then, let's remember to live out our purpose as we live for Christ, we love people, and we make disciples. We'll see you soon.